The year was 1970. If you could have stopped in an Old Forge high school and walked down the hall to the far end of a building, you could have stopped in and saw a young boy of 16 sitting in class behind one of these machines. I was learning to type. When I hit one of the keys, the metal type bar with the same letter would strike the paper and leave the letter on the paper. Every time I hit the letter B, a B would appear on the paper. I was using what was known back then as a typewriter. That little machine got its name from a much earlier form of printing. In 1798, a stereotype was a method of printing from a metal plate. A hot plate had letters formed on it that, as it passed over the paper, would leave the same letters on the page. So, stereotype was the method of forming the same type over and over as the round metal form passed over the paper. The word stereotype also refers to a commonly held mental picture that represents an oversimplified opinion, a prejudiced attitude, or a prejudgment about someone or something. Well, I didn't only learn typing in high school. I also learned a lot about the other kind of typing, stereotyping. As a young boy, growing up in northeastern Pennsylvania, I found myself in a highly ethnic community. The makeup of our town was something like this. 60% were Italians. 20% were Polish. 15% were Russian. And then the rest of us made up about 5% of the population. I knew all the ethnic slurs used on the Polish and all the slurs flung against the Italians. Whenever there was conflict, just like striking the keyboard and getting the same letter all the time, so the same opinions and prejudices got flung around all the time. During this time, I also had my first real exposure to the teachings of Jesus. The strange thing was that a lot of what I was learning was in direct opposition to what I was seeing and hearing lived out all around me. When I went away to college, I began an ongoing process of dismantling my stereotypes, and that process continues to this very day. I've also found myself on the other side of stereotypes. Years back, I started a church geared towards people who want nothing to do with church. I knew that many people had been hurt by churches and pastors, so I was up against a tough crowd. Many had their own stereotypes of pastors. They saw a pastor as judgmental and full of self-righteous opinions. I decided I needed a way to break down some of the stereotypes, so I began growing my hair longer and into a ponytail. When I would tell some folks that I was a pastor, their response, they would look at me and say, "No way." During that time, my daughter had to have her wisdom teeth removed. And so the day came and I took her to the surgeon. It was early in the morning and there were only three of us in the waiting room. My daughter, myself, and another man. Oh, I forgot to tell you. There was a tractor trailer parked in the lot outside. When the surgeon came out and called my daughter and me back for a consultation before her surgery, the doctor looked at me and said, "I saw your truck in the parking lot." He had looked at the three people in the waiting room and picked me for the truck driver. I didn't say anything to him because I think I would have really messed with his mind if I told him I was a pastor. Typing people has been part of our culture since the founding of these United States. From the beginning, the color of a person's skin determined what one could and could not do. Africans were stereotyped and forced to serve as slaves. Treating people poorly, gathering them up and making an opinion on the whole, has a long, long-running history in the land that we live in. These pictures show what happened in the United States after the bombing of Pearl Harbor. All Japanese were stereotyped and interned in camps. At that time, if you were Japanese, you were typed. But you might say, well, that was years ago. We've come a long way from that. Or have we? I want you to pause for a moment and ask yourself this question. Where do I struggle with stereotyping people? Who do I corral into pens and see altogether? Maybe it's racial groups. Maybe it's teenagers or elderly, or women or men, lawyers or truckers, Muslims or Arabs, rich folk or homeless, homosexuals or heterosexuals. Maybe you have some black sheep or scapegoats in your family. If you and I are going to develop a vibrant spirituality, we will have to wrestle with how we view other people. If we are followers of Jesus, we'll have to give up our stereotypes, move beyond merely tolerating people, and treat every human being with the utmost respect. I'm reminded of something that C.S. Lewis said in one of his sermons entitled The Weight of Glory. Let me read it for you. "It is a serious thing to live in a society of possible gods and goddesses, to remember that the dullest, most uninteresting person you can talk to may one day be a creature which, if you saw it now, you would be strongly tempted to worship, or else a horror and a corruption such as you now meet, if at all, only in a nightmare. All day long, we are in some degree helping each other to one or the other of these destinations. It is in the light of these overwhelming possibilities, it is with the awe and the circumspection proper to them, that we should conduct all of our dealings with one another, all friendships, all loves, all play, all politics. There are no ordinary people. You have never talked to a mere mortal. Nations, cultures, arts, civilizations, these are mortal, and their life is to ours as the life of a gnat. But it is immortals whom we joke with, work with, marry, snub, and exploit. Immortal horrors are everlasting splendors." During the days that Jesus lived on earth, racial and ethnic tensions were fairly high. Not just where he grew up, but in the entire world community. the Greeks and the Jews stereotyped each other. The religious and the non-religious stereotyped one another. The slaves and the freemen stereotyped each other. Slurs like barbar or barbarian were slung around. Jesus found himself navigating a very divisive world. And he chose 12 disciples who had grown up in a culture of division. One of the great divisions was between the Jews and the Samaritans. Let me show you what I mean, because it's one of the ways that Jesus was teaching his disciples. He was working with them to dismantle their stereotypes. And so I'm going to take you to some of the places in the New Testament, all of the places in the Gospels that mention the Samaritans. Snapshot one, overcoming avoidance. The story of Jesus and his interaction with the Samaritan woman starts with a few particular words. It says this, now he had to go through Samaria. I came to understand these words years ago when I was studying in Israel. We had been traveling to various biblical sites as part of our education. We were disappointed when we had heard that we would not be visiting Samaria. And when we asked why not, this is what we heard. The last bus, when they were there, were stoned. A few of us were not going to be deterred. And so the crazy young people that we were, we looked for an Arab taxi cab driver. Now, you have to understand, you were safer with an Arab taxi cab driver than a Jewish driver in Samaria. And so we went to Jacob's Well and captured some great photos and were able to see the place of Jacob's Well. In the time of Jesus, most Jewish people who were traveling this region would go around Samaria, even though it made for a longer journey, rather than go through it because of the strong animosity between the two groups. Jesus, we're told, rather than avoiding the area, took his disciples right through it. I can just imagine the disciples questioning, why did we come this way? There is a whole bunch packed into this story. But one would wonder, did he come this way to teach his disciples that you don't avoid the people who you have a tendency to stereotype? Move with me to snapshot two, identifying with the other. There is an exchange in John chapter 9 between Jesus and the Pharisees, where they throw ethnic slurs at Jesus. In the exchange, there is a subtle but meaningful response that Jesus gives. This is what the Pharisees threw at Jesus. Aren't we right in saying that you are a Samaritan and demon-possessed? If you look closely, Jesus denies that he is demon-possessed, but gives no response to the ethnic slur that he's a Samaritan. I can just imagine the disciples wondering, why didn't he disclaim that he was a Samaritan? Why not say, I'm a Jew just like you? Jesus didn't hide in his group's identity. I wonder if Jesus wasn't teaching something about identifying with people who you have a tendency to stereotype. Another snapshot of another area of the mentioning of Samaritans, exploring the inner world. Here's another time that Jesus went through Samaria. Jesus sent some of the messengers ahead of him to get some things ready for him as he was going through Samaria. The Samaritans didn't welcome him because he was going to Jerusalem. That's why people usually went around Samaria, not Jesus. Now, something I learned in high school, as long as things were going okay, you'd never know that the Italians had animosity towards the Polish. But when some conflict came up, that was on the inside, and it exploded onto the outside. Similar things happened here. When the Samaritans weren't being welcoming, the inner feelings and thoughts of the disciples exploded. Here's what they said. Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven and destroy them? And we're told that Jesus rebuked them. Just in case the disciples thought that just because those other people, those Samaritans, didn't treat us right, we could destroy them, Jesus set them straight. Another snapshot of the Samaritans. Guess who's the hero? Most people know the story of the Good Samaritan. Let me show it to you from another vantage point. How Jesus develops the story. The two men who passed by the man in need were from the dominant culture. Jesus chose a Samaritan to be the hero. Remember, Jesus wanted to, remember the disciples wanted to burn the Samaritans, and now Jesus makes a Samaritan the bright spot of the story. And all of this was in response to a question as to who is my neighbor. I wonder if Jesus wasn't teaching the disciples an important lesson that the people they had a tendency to stereotype were in fact their neighbors and also a possible hero. Snapshot 5. In Luke 17, this story happens when Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He was on the border between Galilee and Samaria. 10 men with leprosy call out to Jesus for pity, and Jesus heals all 10 of them. Here's where the story gets interesting. 9 were from the good side of town, Galilee. 1 was from the bad side of town, Samaria. Only 1 returned to say thank you to Jesus. And scripture says, and he was a Samaritan. Now, if you put all of these snapshots together, you'll get a feeling for how to dismantle stereotypes. It's as if Jesus was setting a lesson plan in place to help disciples, his disciples, but also us, to dismantle any stereotype we might have. And this is how you do it. Right from the stories of Jesus. First, you associate with the people whom you have a stereotype. You don't avoid them. You associate with them. Second, you identify with people as human beings and not through your stereotype. You see, Jesus related to Samaritans as human beings, not as Samaritans. Human beings that he created, just like his disciples were part of his creation as well. Three, let God examine the inner world of your thoughts and feelings towards those you stereotype. You see, God has direct access to our inner life. And just like in the story where the disciples, when they were not treated well by the Samaritans, what was inside exploded out. Let God examine and explore. You know, we can say nice things with our mouth, but our heart is where the truth comes from. Let him examine that to see where you stand with others. Four, if you want to dismantle stereotypes, tell positive stories about those whom you stereotype. And this is exactly what Jesus does. He has the Samaritan as the favorite one, the hero of the story. Usually, if you think about it, the people that are stereotyped, the stories told about them are not good stories. They're not hero stories. But this is one of the ways, if you want to dismantle, if you have people that you tend to stereotype, tell good stories about them. Five, look for the good in those whom you stereotype and look for the not so good of your own group. Boy, all you have to do is listen to the conversation that's in our communities and in our world today of how people talk about the other group. What Jesus does is look for the good. Look for the good. The one who says thank you from that other group. And look at well as the not so good in our own group. The early church saw themselves as taking on a new identity that somehow in Christ we would all be free of the need for stereotypes, that we would leave our old ways and live a new way of life, that we would see ourselves as human beings and see others as human beings as well. Listen to this passage of scripture. You used to walk in these ways, in an earthly manner, in the life you once lived. But now you must rid yourselves of all such things as these, anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here, there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. This week, let's live in Christ. And if we do that, we will respect all people. Let's pray together. Father, we kneel before you, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. We pray that out of your glorious riches, you may strengthen us with power through your Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And we pray that we may be rooted and established in love, and may have power, together with all your people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we would be filled to the full measure of all your fullness. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to your power that is at work in us, to you be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning. My poem this morning is called Hate Versus Love. Don't judge people by their color. Look beyond their skin for more. You may find a good friend forever if you kick bigotry out the door. Your neighbors may be Catholic, Lutheran, Buddha, or Muslim. Don't judge people by their religion. There's good and bad in all of them. Put prejudice and bigotry behind you. Don't let hate reign over love. One country, one people, united. That's America, the land we love.
Sounds of freedom. there is a new